بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقي لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد sisters and brothers in iman السلام عليكم. This is the fifth session that we have on this topic of self-building or spiritual development or maintaining the spiritual health. And the last session was 2 weeks ago. What I would like to do is just connect with the stage of our discussion by talking about the different stages of self-development that we talked about. If you remember, the fundamental problem is the problem known as ghaflat. Not even think about this issue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why we are here, and what is the goal and the purpose. And the way we would get out of that is a state known as yaqza, or awakening. And that is followed by the state of tawbah and istighfar as a component of that first stage. And then the second stage was muhasaba and muraqaba, to always be, you know, self-assessing oneself and to be also vigilant against the attack by shaitan and what is known as junud al-shayateen, the army of the shaitan. And then we reach to the third stage, which is known as the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason why we separated the third one from the first and second is because the first and second were just the process of cleansing our spiritual heart in order to then, you know, rebuild it. And in that state, zikr was the most essential, you know, step. We talked about the meaning of zikr, the levels and different dimensions of zikr. We ended up the discussion talking about the barriers in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are three elements, you know, as far as the barriers are concerned. And that was the issue of shaitan, wealth, and family. We went through it very quick, just giving a listing. And I got questions, and I thought maybe there's need to elaborate on that, what we mean by barriers, you know, in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes to the first one, the shaitan, you know, we know that there is total negativity there. There is nothing positive about shaitan. We can learn things from him in the early stages of his, you know, discussion and arguments with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it comes to what happened after that, after Adam and Hawa came down to the earth, you know, shaitan is aduwwun mubeen. He is the open enemy of the human beings. And so there is a need for the wayfarer, the person who is in the spiritual path of spiritual development, to be constantly vigilant of the attack by the shaitan, especially when it comes to the gray area. You see, shaitan, first of all, doesn't worry about the people who are in the casino. He is more worried about the people who are, you know, masjidi, in a way, or those who are practicing and committed to the faith. And there also, the area that shaitan finds easy access is what is known as the gray area. And therefore, we have to be vigilant all the time. Let me talk about this gray area by using an example from the Qur'an, that there are places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تقربوا. Do not even go close to certain things, certain actions. He doesn't say, don't do it, which is known. You are not allowed to do it. But he says, لا تقربوا. Do not even go close to it. Why? Because even if you don't have the intention of doing it, going close to it is the opportunity which will come, you know, available for the shaitan to misguide the person, and then it's easier for him to, you know, put the person on the wrong track. And it's interesting that when we look at the four or five ayat in Qur'an, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this term, la taqrabu, do not even get close to it. Or don't get, you know, even near it. There are two kinds of issues that he talks about. Number one, al-fawahish. In Surah An'am, Ayat 151, and Surah Isra, Ayat 32. In the first one, he talks about fawahish, indecent acts of all different kinds. He says, ma zahara minha wa ma batan, what is obvious, what is hidden, what is, you know, minor or minor or major. And in Surah Isra, he uses the term, wala taqrabu zina. Do not get close to zina. Means do not even put yourself in a situation where temptation would be there. You know, sometimes we hear from our youths that, you know, I'm sure about myself. I have my friends going to the club. I'm not going to drink. I'm not going to be part of, you know, haram activities there. But they are my friends. I want to go there. And this is what they do not realize. Shaitan will not go out of those other people. Shaitan will actually target this one individual who says, I will go there and not do anything. And this is where we are told, don't even get close to that environment where the temptation would be there, peer pressure would be there, you know, to commit sin. And so the first issue is the love for flesh. The second is, the words are more about orphans, but it covers general. وَلَا تَقْرَبُ مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ إِلَّا الَّتِي بِيَ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. You know, do not touch the property of the orphan who are under your care, except that you do it in the right way. So there also the issue is, لَا تَقْرَبُ. Do not even go close to this act of doing something which you will, you know, do haram. And this is where we see the severity of the issue. So the other would be the love for wealth. And these are the two, you know, challenges that, you know, human beings have in general as far as the dunya is concerned. And so we go to the second and the third barrier of the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the wealth and the family. When it comes to the issue of wealth and family, number one, they are not totally negative like the shaitan. But they have the potential of becoming a barrier in our path of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being aware of what He wants us to do. And this all depends on the situation. When it comes to the wealth, for example, we know this is Allah's blessing. But we always have to keep in mind that the wealth has been created for us. We have not been created for the wealth. You know, the dunya is for us, we are not for dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in one of the hadithi Qudsi, He says, you know, خَلَقْتُ الْأَشْيَا لِأَجْلِكَ. I have created everything for you, and I have created you for myself. And that is in essence the meaning of إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We belong to Him. You know, we don't belong to this dunya. And so it's not the wealth itself which is a problem. It is the nature of our relationship and attachment to the wealth which can become problem and a barrier in our path. Let us look at one or two ayat of Quran on this issue. When it comes to the wealth, this is an ayat from Surah Al Imran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Zuyyina lin-nas hubbu shahawat," the love of desires have been made, you know, fair or good in the eyes of the people. Unfortunately, that statement is missing from the translation here. I intended to put it at the end of the sentence, and I forgot on there. But anyway, the love of desires, including women and children, accumulated piles of gold and silver, horses of mark. Very few people among us would buy a horse, but, you know, yes, there are people in dunya who buy horses for that. Livestock and farms, these have been made Zuyyina, zinat for people. Adornment for the people. Who has made it? Shaitan has been made it, has done this. Those are the wares of the life of this dunya. You know, ذَلِكَ مَطَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. But what is with Allah is a good destination. And so here, in a way, we are told that the love for these things, the love of desire for all these things, can become a problem for us. Another ayat on this issue would be from Surah Tawbah. Let me use this example. And so, you know, when we look at the stories, in Surah Tawbah, there is a very interesting story, which is not in the surah itself, but these three ayat actually came down as a reason for that story. There was a person by the name of Sa'laba bin Hatib. He was a poor person, a Muslim in Medina, very regular in his salat, awwal waqt, mashallah. You know, doesn't miss any prayers. And he used to always ask Rasulullah that, you know, pray for me, I'm poor. And Rasulullah's initial response always was, Ya Tha'laba, qaleelun tu'addi shukrahu khayrun min kathirin la tutiqu. Little bit of the wealth that you have for which you are grateful to Allah is better for you than, you know, abundance of mal, which you cannot. Now the word la tatiquhu, tatiquhu, could mean what you cannot handle. You are overwhelmed with it, and so the shukr goes away. You know, so if you have less and you are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is better than having more, but then you start forgetting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he says, Ama laka fi rasulillahi uswatun hasana. Rasulullah says, you know, look at me. I'm a very simple man. I have a simple life. Aren't you happy to live like me? And he goes on to say that I, you know, by my soul, that if you live like me, you know, you can attain levels much higher than what you are thinking about. But, you know, the poor fellow insisted. Till a time comes where Rasulullah, you know, he didn't only that dua. Yeah, this fellow actually came and pledged. And he pledged, he says, Ya Rasulullah, ud'u Allah an yarzuqani malan walladhi ba'asaka bilhaq la'in radhaqani malan la'utiyanna kulladhi haqqin haqqa. He says, I pledge with you in the name of Allah that if Allah gives me wealth, I will fulfill the dues, those who are, you know, sahib haq, those who have right in my wealth, I will, you know, pay. And when he made that pledge, this is where Rasulullah basically prayed for him. And if he prays, you know, mashallah, Allah will respond. And so he ended up somehow managing, you know, to buy, you know, sheep, a couple of them. And they multiplied and grew in number. And he ended up becoming a wealthy person. But what happened to him at the end? To accommodate the herd of the sheep, they became so large in number that his place in Medina was not sufficient. He moved outside in the suburb area, Porsche area, if you use the term. You know, more farms and this and that, in order to accommodate his growing business. And then that also expanded, that he was even forced to leave that place and even go even far further away. And while his business was expanding, his money is increasing, his wealth is going up and up, gradually his attendance to the daily prayers stop. I'm busy, you know, and then even Juma prayers also. Well, maybe he was outside, and so it was not wajib, so it wasn't an issue shar'an, but his commitment to what is known as the, you know, doing of wajibat in that way was no more there. He was very busy in his business. A time comes where Allah's messenger sent a zakat collector, revenue officer. They go to Tha'laba, he has so many sheep. You know, it's time for him to pay zakat. For so many animals, he has to pay this much as zakat. And this first person goes and he says that, you know, Rasulullah has sent me to collect zakat from you. What does he say? He said, I'm not a, you know, Christian or Yahud that you're asking jizya from me. I'm a Muslim. Jizya was the tax applied on non-Muslims in a Muslim state because they don't have to pay zakat or why and this. And he says, probably this was the time when zakat was introduced, so it was something new. And he says, you know, really this is a disguised form of jizya put on me. Ukhtuz jizya, he uses the word. This is the sister of jizya. So it's not only that he's postponing it, delaying it, or saying, you know, oh, my business is not good these days. You know, he actually is challenging the command of Rasulullah about it. Ridiculing this whole issue of zakat as, you know, a disguised form of jizya on Muslims. This revenue officer comes back to Rasulullah, and Rasulullah was very much disappointed, especially keeping in mind that Sa'alaba had pledged to him. And so he just said, you know, this person, you know, he uses the word wayh 2-3 times for him. Jibreel then comes down with these 3 ayat. And this ayat, although they are very general, but this is about this fellow. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, among them are those who made a pledge with Allah. It's interesting that he made the pledge with Rasulullah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the pledge that you make with Rasul is as if you are making it with me. And what was his pledge? If he gives us out of his grace, we will surely give the charity, and we will surely be among the righteous ones. But when he gave them out of his grace, they became niggardly, they became bakhil, and turned away, and they became disregardful towards the Prophet. And so what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do here? This person has brought this on himself. He's responsible for the azab which is coming now. And so Allah says, so he caused hypocrisy, nifaq, to ensue in their hearts until the day they will encounter him. Basically, this fellow is doomed now. It's Allah is saying till the day of Qiyamah. Because of their going back on what they had promised Allah and because of the lies they used to tell. And so this is a very serious issue. And when we look at this example, this is where we come to realize that, you know, mal is good. It is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it also has the potential of becoming a barrier in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the extent of this example of Tha'laba that we have in the in Surah Tawbah. And that is why you will see our imams in, you know, Sixth Imam and others also have used the term where they say, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا رَأْسُ كُلِّ خَطِيَةٍ. The love of this dunya is actually the head of all wrongdoings, or is the root of all wrongdoings. One more ayat on this theme, and this is about family. This is the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Ma al-mal wal-banun zinat hayat al-dunya." Positively, that wealth and children are the beauty or adornment for this worldly life. وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرُ عَمَلًا. But the everlasting good deeds with your Lord are a better reward and a better hope for salvation. It's interesting that مَال and بَنُون is on one side and بَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتِ is on the opposite side. Which means that it's مَال and بَنُون could be hayat of zinat of hayat al-dunya, but it has the potential of becoming the other way. And this is where we have to keep in mind, you know, two situations. Either if it is handled properly, the family and the wealth, then it can end up becoming amal salih and becomes part of al-baqiyat salihat, everlasting good deeds with Allah. But if this whole process is not handled properly, then it can become not amal salih but amal talih. There is another opposite word for it in Arabic. Amal talih means an evil deed. And so again, we see there is a potential. We are not saying that family is a bad thing. No, you know, Anbiya and Mursaleen had family, our Imams have family. We can't, you know, survive without families. They have been praised, their rights and duties, talked about it in Islam. But the main thing is that we should know that if a time comes to make the choice between family and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, between mal and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our choice should be the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An example, you know, since we just went through the Ayyam Fatimiya, in the battle of Jamal, one of the key players of that event is Zubair, Zubair bin Al-Awwam. He's cousin of Ali, cousin of Rasulullah. And he was with Ali in the event of Saqifah. He was one of those 10 to 12 individuals who were inside the house of Fatima, salawatullah alayha, as a protest against the demand of bay'at from the first Khalifa. And that's the reason why the house was basically attacked. And one of those who was there, who actually came out first with his sword open, to defend, was Zubair. He was there even in the Shura when the third Khalifa was selected, and he sided with the choice of Ali. But then in Jamal, we see he's on the other side. Both things were there. Wealth was there, dunya, as well as the family. Because Zubair, along with Talha, were the first one to do bay'at on the hand of Ali, as a Khalifa. But they had certain conditions in their mind. Ali said, no, I didn't really, there was no conditional bay'at with me. You just do the bay'at unconditionally. But they had some their own expectations that they will be made governors of this and that province. And when Ali did not consider them to be worthy of that, although Zubair was his cousin and supporter, Ali said, no, you don't deserve this position. He turned against. So that is mal we see. And then there was another element. Amir al-Mu'min used to say himself, in Jamal, he used to say, until his son Abdullah, the son of Zubair, had not grown up, Zubair was with us. But when Abdullah grew up, started having influence on his father, and he was actually from mother's side, a nephew of, you know, Aisha. And so he had his own influence there. And he basically changed the mind of his father, Zubair. And so we see that, you know, wealth and family can have impact on the decisions that people make. And that is where we have to be careful that, you know, family members or wealth do not become a barrier in pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us go back to the you know, stages and go to the next step. We went from ghaflat to yaqza, awakening. It was coupled with tawbah and istighfar, then muhasaba and muraqaba. Then we talked about the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third stage is basically the stage we'll discuss today, and that is known as riyazat. Anybody here named by Mr. Riyazat? Anybody knows the meaning of their name? Okay. This is also a very important stage with zikr. Of course, you know, the scholars would like to use this term, but there are very simpler terms which can be used. Let me explain what does it mean. The word riyazat itself in Arabic means practice or exercise for something, to train for something. And initially this was actually used for training a horse for race or for use in warfare. During the old days, you know, horse was an important element as far as, you know, techniques of war is concerned. So you just don't get a horse and start using it for these purposes. You have to actually train the horse for that purpose. And it basically involved many things. You have to feed it the right diet. You have to train it, especially if you want it as a race horse, jogging 3 to 6 miles daily, increasing the speed and frequency as it becomes, you know, stronger and has more stamina. You have to take care of, you know, bathing the horse and take care of the shoes and the legs. And so why do people do that? When it comes to training of the horse, they do it so that the horse can become the winner. And so that horse would be distinct from the horses which are there in the wild, which have not gone through that process of being trained for this specific purpose. And this is where, you know, we see that when it comes to spiritual development, it's not just, you know, knowing these things. Riyazat is an essential condition for spiritual development. We have to develop ourselves, we have to train ourselves in order to, you know, master the forces that we have so that they are not used in the wrong way. Rather, we control them to use it in the right way. Now, I use this example of horse because of the word. It was initially used for training of horses, and then it's used in Arabic language for more general things, including spiritual training. Let me now give you an exercise here. We don't have so many copies, so what we will do is, everybody now reads on the screen, so we don't have actually print copies. This is Dua-e-Kumail. You read it every week. Just give one to one row. And they can discuss and find out. So we'll see which row becomes number one here. You recite Dua-e-Kumail every week. What I would like you to do, and this is a time limit exercise, within 2 minutes, maximum three, identify the passage where spiritual exercise has been described in terms similar to physical training on racetrack. As if you are actually racing on a, you know, racetrack. There is a passage there in Dua-e-Kumail. Find it first, just raise your hand. Every week. No? What does it say?
Now I've come to thee, my God, after. Is it number 56?
What does it say? I don't know the numbers. You read it to me. What is the number? Huh? Just a minute. Read the wordings first. Yeah, that's it. You? Yeah. Okay, so we have two from here, two from here. That's good. Right at the end of Dua-e-Kumail. قوي على خدمتك جوارحي واشدد على عزيمة جوانحي وحبل الجد في خشيتك والدوام في الاتصال بخدمتك حتى أصرح إليك في ميادين السابقين. ميادين is plural of ميدان. What is ميدان? Huh? So basically what you are saying there, at the end of the dua, you are praying, strengthen my limbs for your service, ibadat and everything else. Sustain the strength of my hands. Now, hands doesn't just mean hands, means, you know, the energy part of the bodies. To persevere and grant me the seriousness to fear you and consistency in attachment to your service, so that I freely move towards you in the fields with the foremost ones and go speedily towards you among those who surpass. So basically, even the spiritual path, in a way, is, you know, we talk about competing for what? You know, who has the most of children in the khandan and the extended family, or who has more wealth or bigger house or the latest car and this and that. This is the musabaqa, this is the competition which should be there. That, you know, in this we would like to go with those who are sabiqeen, you know, who surpass the others. We would like to be among them. And so even in this dua, you know, we have this concept of, you know, moving in a race track on a spiritual level. And for that, just as the horse race, we have to have training and exercise. And so basically the riyazat that we are talking about can be of two types, physical as well as spiritual. When we talk about spiritual training, we are actually talking about, you know, controlling the excessive love for this dunya and the people around us. We are not saying Islam says don't love things, don't love people. It shouldn't be excessive to the extent that it goes against the love for Allah, Rasul, and the Imam of the time. And basically, the term that we can use for this is jihad bin nafs. It's a very simple word, easier, you know, riyazat and jihad bin nafs would be one and the same thing. And this is where we are talking about training ourselves constantly so that our nafs becomes nafs lawwama and not nafs ammara. And only then we'll be able to attain the level of itmi'inan. But this cannot be done only by reading or, you know, discussing or knowing these words and things. It needs this riyazat, training, constantly working on myself in order to attain that ability. Just to emphasize that point, let me go to Amir al-Mu'mineen again. It's amazing, you know, whatever you talk about these issues, he's there always. he says something very interesting in one of the sermons, although initial part of it is irrelevant to this theme. But later on, you know, this is complaining about the people of Kufa who don't have this willingness to go for whatever he is asking them to do. Then he says at the end, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ عِبَادُ اللَّهِ وَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Think about it. O people, fear Allah and flee towards Allah from Allah. What does it mean? Firru ila Allah min Allah. Run towards Allah from Allah. Basically, what it means is that, you know, run towards the mercy of Allah from the ghadab and wrath of Allah. And then, how do you do that? وَمْزُوا فِي الَّذِي نَهَجَهُ لَكُمْ وَقُومُوا بِمَا عَصَبَهُ بِكُمْ. You know, trade on the path he has laid down for you. So there is a path. He's already, you know, laid down for us. We have to walk on it. And then, وَقُومُوا بِمَا عَصَبَهُ بِكُمْ, and stand by what he has tied onto you. The horse also has to be tied. The rider, when he, you know, rides on the horse, he controls that. And so we are there. The Sharia are the controls. It will move us to the right or the left or in the right direction, stop us where we are to be stopped. And so we have to move towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a path which has been fixed, but there are restraints on us. And the restraints are known as the laws of the Sharia. And this is the powerful statement from him. فَعَلِيٌّ ضَامِنٌ لِفَلْجِكُمْ عَاجِلًا إِن لَمْ تَمْنُحُوهُ عَاجِلًا. He says, if you do this, Ali will guarantee your success eventually if you don't attain it in this dunya. Do this. Ali is Zamin. He is the one who is guarantor for your success in this path. You know, I don't think anybody else than Ali can say that. And so he's actually putting himself as a guarantor for this. He says, I am Zamin for your success. If not in this dunya, then you will get it in the hereafter if you do that. So you have to run towards the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the path that he has laid down by following the restraints which he has put on us in form of the Sharia laws. And therefore, actually, in one of the statements, he says, "Ash-Sharia Riyazatun Nafs." The word Riyazat. In one of his short sayings, he uses this term. He said, "Sharia is the exercise for the training of the nafs." So the Sharia laws, you know, we consider it to be burdensome and this and that, but these laws are there in order to train us to move with the speed in the right direction towards the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One more ayat on this issue. فَأَمَّا مَنْ تَغَى وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمِ هِيَ الْمَعْوَى. The one who rebels and prefers the worldly life. You see, we are not saying you shouldn't love the worldly life, but preferring it over the akhirah is the problem. So one who rebels and prefers the worldly life, verily hell is the destination. But the one who fears his Lord's status, مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَحَ النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْحَوَى, and prevents his soul from evil desires, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَعْوَى. Verily the paradise is the destination for this individual. The issue of, you know, مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ. Whoever fears the status of Allah as the Lord, as the one who can punish us. This is taqwa. We don't fear him as a person. We fear his displeasure and his anger and his punishment. And taqwa basically is reflected in وَنَحَ النَّفْسِ عَنِ الْحَوَى, to prevent us from our evil desires. And so this is where, again, we can tie the whole concept of, you know, spiritual building and riyazat with taqwa. And taqwa leads us to zuhud. Zuhud doesn't mean to leave the whole dunya and go in the cave and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Zuhud means to abstain from the evil. Not even to abstain from the blessings of Allah, but to abstain from the evil things in this dunya. In his letter to Osman bin Hunayf, one of his governors in Basra, was invited to a dinner by affluent people where poor people were kept away. You know, it's a long khutbah letter, actually. There he says, Amir al-Mu'minin uses the words, and you're focusing here on the concept of riyazat, training ourselves, where he says, as for my nafs, فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ نَفْسِي عَرُوزُهَا عَرُوزُهَا is the word for riyazat. He says, as for my nafs, I train it. By training it, by what? By taqwa. So that on the day of great fear, it will be peaceful and steady in slippery places. Very interesting. Again, we're talking about places where the road could be slippery, and you need the nafs as your horse to be peaceful and steady in that path. And that's where the riyazat of nafs comes in, training of this of the soul bit taqwa on the basis of taqwa. Before I go on next, one or two points. It's important that, you know, when we talk about riyazat and the training, many times we hear so-and-so spiritual person said do this and that. We don't have a problem with that as long as the statement or amal of that individual can be traced back to the saying or action of a masoom. We cannot go into this process of, you know, for example, there's many of these, what we call, in the Hindu tradition, for example, there are some of these holy men who do riyazat. They will stand up on their one leg for a month or so. I don't know how they do it, but they do it. Or they do something very unusual. This is also known as riyazat. We do not believe in a riyazat which is not based on the Sharia principles and the sayings or the example of the Masumin. Anything else from any other source, whether it is the Hindu or the Buddhist or the Christian or Sufis, you know, that's not the path that we need. For us, Ahlul Bayt are sufficient. They reflect the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so now, what is the first step? This is the stage we are talking about, riyazat. In a riyazat, there are different actions which are taught to us what to do. And the very first one is a difficult one today, but anyway, we'll try to talk about it. May Allah give us the strength and tawfiq to follow it. It's surprising, you know, the first step in riyazat, in spiritual training, so that we can control our, you know, desires, has to do with the control of food. Huh? Diet industry would be very happy with this statement. But this is the first thing. Normally in the books of, you know, spiritual training, they use the word hunger. That the first step in riyazat is hunger. But sometimes that term could be misleading. It's not an issue of being hungry. It's the issue of controlling the desire for food and drink. And coupled with that is this desire for sexual desires. Now, it is the nature of attachment which can make this blessing into a problem for us. So food is not something which is bad in Islam. It is the issue that we have to be in control, and it's not the food which is going to control us. You know, the way people say it, that, you know, you eat to survive. You don't survive to eat. You know, you eat so that you can live. You don't live for eating. And that is the reality that we have to keep in mind. For example, if you look at the ayat of Quran, and again, there's too much wordings there in the screen, but anyway, the concept was to give this example of control. You know, there are certain losers who do certain things, and one of the things is forbid what Allah has provided them. So Islam is not saying don't eat. fabricating a lie against Allah. Certainly they have gone astray and are not guided. The following ayat, it is He who produced gardens of all different kinds, palm trees, crops, olives, pomegranates, similar, dissimilar kind of fruits. Eat of its fruits when it's ready and give its dues on the day of harvest. And do not be wasteful. وَلَا تُسْرِفُ. The issue of israf is just one example. So eat, but don't do israf. The matter of control is being emphasized here because إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُصْرِفِينَ. Allah doesn't like those who do israf. Another ayat on that same theme, يَا بَنِي آدَمْ خُزُوا زِينَتُكُمْ إِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. O the children of Adam, when you go to any masjid, put on your, you know, beautiful clothes and perfume, or adorn yourself when you go to masjid. وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُصْرِفُوا. And eat and drink. Even if he didn't say eat and drink, we would eat and drink. Because he created us in that way. You know, he has created this desire in us. We cannot survive without it. But the main command is وَلَا تُصْرِفُوا. And do not do israf. Don't be wasteful. And then he says, وَقُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةُ اللَّهِ الَّتِي أَخْرَجَ لِعِبَادِهِ. Who has forbidden the adornment of Allah that He has brought forth for His servants and the goodies from the sustenance? And this is where we had to realize that we are not talking about staying hungry. It's not the word Jew and Gurisnagi in Farsi or hunger is translation there where it has come. Even in the writings and even in the hadith, it doesn't mean to stay hungry. What it means is that be in control. Do not become slave of the food. And this is where we have to realize, you know, there was a movement just not that far away in the West among some of the Shia youths of becoming, you know, going into vegan diet, refraining from meat, in order to build ourselves spiritually. No, there's nothing, Islam doesn't promote that. It's not an issue that eating meat is a problem. You know, there is a difference between eating less meat and totally abstaining from meat. Rasulullah used to like meat, especially one portion of, one part of the camel he really used to like than the other part of the camel. Probably it was the shoulder part of the camel. You know, our imams is to eat meat. So there's nothing like that to become spiritual, you have to refrain from meat and become vegetarian. No. The issue is control yourself. Do not become slave of the food. Some ahadiths on that issue of controlling the appetite for food, and that's how we will end tonight. Number one, this is what the Prophet is saying. نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ لَا نَأْكُلُ حَتَّى نَجُوعُ وَإِذَا أَكَلْنَا لَا نَشْبَعُ. We are the people who don't eat until we become hungry. So if you don't feel hungry, don't eat. And when we are hungry and we sit down to eat, we don't fill up our, you know, it's not, you know, when you go to a gas station, you say fill up. There's no issue of filling up there. So you eat, you know, but do not, you know, the main thing is do not fill up your bellies. There is another statement from Amir al-Mu'minin where he talks about this example, or one of the imams, where, you know, leave some space in your stomach, where one third food, one third water, one third air. Air means empty. And so the issue of, you know, eating is there, but not to the extent that it becomes gluttony and, you know, overeating. Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam says, nothing is most abhorrent, abghabu ilallah, to Almighty Allah than a full belly. It creates problem in namaz, you know, you don't even sleep well. And you can't just wake up that easily. So there are all issues there. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam again says, nothing is more harmful for a believer's soul than gluttony, kathrat al-aql, eating more. And it actually causes two things, qaswatul qalb wa hijanu shahwa, hardness of the soul and heightening of the desires. And then he says, وَالْجُوعُ عِدَامٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِ وَغَضَاءٌ لِلْرُوحِ وَطَعَامٌ لِلْقَلْبِ وَصَحَّةٌ لِلْبَدَنِ. Whereas hunger, now again, remember, hunger doesn't mean, this is actually opposite of gluttony, overeating. So here we are not talking about being totally hungry. It means eating in a way that you still have that, you know, portion of a hunger still there. That hunger is a believer's curry. Idam, you know, what you eat with, whatever you eat with the bread. So we would call it salan. The curry is a believer's curry and a nutrition for soul and food for spirit. And it is health for body. When we look at the words ruh and qalb, of course we are talking about, you know, ruh is more a spiritual thing, whereas qalb is more a physical entity. One more hadith from Amir al-Mu'minin where he says, نِعْمُ الْعَوْنَ عَلَى أَسْرِ النَّفْسِ وَكَسْرِ عَادَتِهَا التَّجَوُّعُ. The best help for harnessing the nafs, the, you know, the desires that we have, and breaking its evil habits is hunger. Again, hunger doesn't mean totally hungry. It means eating it only, you know, to survive and sustain ourselves, not overeating. Three other things that we have to always, especially if we are talking about building ourselves spiritually, and this is important for everyone anyway, that the food should be halal. Number two, it has to be pak. You know, the item could be halal, but, you know, the way it's made would be a problem. And the most important thing, the source of that has to be mubah. And this goes back to our, you know, source of earning. And these things have an impact in our life. Let us end with this statement from Imam Hussein alayhi salam, where on the day of Ashura, he says to the Yazidi army, he says, وَيْلَكُمْ مَا عَلَيْكُمْ أَن تَنْصِتُوا إِلَيَّا فَتَسْمَعُوا قَوْلِي. What is happening to you? What is the matter that you don't hear me so that you may listen to my words? While I'm talking to you, taking you, not talking, I'm taking you to the path of wisdom. It means I'm calling you to come to the path of wisdom, but you are not listening to me, not hearing me out. And then he says, why? Why are you doing this way? He even gives the reason. He says, مُلِعَتْ بُطُونَكُمْ مِنَ الْحَرَامِ فَطَبَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ. Your bellies are filled with haram. Haram food can have an impact. It can become a barrier, even if Imam Hussein is there advising us. You know, you can't have a better advisor than Imam Hussein, alayhi salam. Sayyid al-Shabab Ahl al-Jannah, one of the two, you know, chief of the youths of paradise, grandson of Rasulullah Ma'soom. He's talking to you and that doesn't have impact. You know, many times we say, oh, we need another person to come and talk to people so that maybe they will listen in. Sometimes we don't realize it's not the speaker, it's the listener. Maybe there is a barrier there. And this is what it is. You have Imam Hussain alayhi salam there. You don't need anyone else. But they are not listening to him. They are not hearing him out. Why? Because their bellies are filled with haram, and as a consequence of that, Allah has punished them. How He has punished them? He has sealed their hearts. And when Allah seals the heart, nothing can go in there. And so food has an impact, and therefore the first step in the stage of riyadhat is to control our desire for food and drink. It's not that you don't eat or drink, but get out of this, you know, we have to get out of this not the habit, but actually the slavery of the food and drink. And that is where people get into difficulties, you know, then realize this is maybe haram, maybe doubtful, but they like it. When we say, I like it, that's the problem. And we have to train ourselves to get out of this problem of, I like it. We have to see whether my Imam likes it or not, my Rasul likes it or not, my Allah likes it or not. It's not me. And that's where we'll get the nur from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, give us the tawfiq to understand these and, you know, practice and have the courage to work on these issues, inshallah. Yes. Yes, fasting plays with the issue of hunger. Fasting is one of the important ways. We actually ran out of time, and so we'll continue this, inshallah, later on about fasting. It could be. It could be the earnings and the source of what they have to buy their food. The food might be okay, but the money they are using would be illegitimate, yes. Well, it covers everything. It's not only that it was not slaughtered properly or they were buying it from other sources. The issue is that it's coming from the income which is earned in a haram way. Especially in the West, we have serious problems on this issue when it comes to what we are eating. There's a Maulana in the UK, he says that, you know, we don't know. We probably, if we lived here 20 years or more, we might have, you know, at least at half of the pig. But he was just talking about the situation in the UK. You know, there was a time when the BBC actually did this investigative reporting about halal meat in Muslim shops, and they realized that many of these products, but they just used to just put the label there saying halal, but it was coming from all different sources. And so, yes, there are issues. And this is one part of that riyazat to make sure that what we eat is proper. Yes, yes. That affects our namaz, our hajj, everything. So inshallah, next week, since the namaz time would be a bit earlier, we might start at 8 and take a break for namaz and then come back. Okay, so we'll start at 8, the program, break for namaz and come back.